Hello YouTube viewers, welcome to my show Camera Tuesday. In today's episode, I want to give you guys a clear-cut warning about buying APS-C lens. So please understand this, it's not a good idea. So let's pay a closer attention to it. Now, this whole idea of changing lens is the backbone of interchangeable lens systems. That is the whole point. And the sole reason we even bother to do it is very simple. It's right tool for the right job. Like this lens is suited for something. This lens is suited for something. That lens is suited for some things. So each lens is basically tailor-made for one specific purpose. If you do those sort of lens, like let's say you have a zoom lens that, you know, have a basically very controllable range, as in magnification, as in the millimeter rating changes, but if you focus it on, let's say, from 70 millimeter to 300 millimeter, you're gonna get a very good picture. Now compared to that, let's say you try to make a lens that goes from 18 to 300, you're not gonna get a very sharp 18, nor you're gonna get a very sharp 300, simply because that range is too far apart. For this sort of reason, whenever lenses are being designed, especially professional lenses, they try to focus it, like, you know, to a very narrow band of operation. So they will try to, if it's a wide angle lens, they will try to keep from 18 to 35 to 40 or let's say 70. They will not exceed that. If that's for telephoto, they will have a very clear cut range, like 300 to 200. I'm saying 300 to 200, I mean like 70 to 200, that is the most professional lens you can go for wedding and portrait photography. Then for a bit more wider range, you will have 200 to 400, 400 to 600, because if you do like this, like, you know, having gaps in your system, that way you can design an optic that does not go from, like, you know, the field of view does not go from like this wide angle to like this for telephoto. So if you go from here to here, designing a lens that can handle that is much easier. Designing a lens that can handle like this to this, that's really not good for quality. So for this reason, we like the idea of interchangeable lens. Right tool for the right job. Now your camera is very small, practically speaking. Even a DSLR like these, I'm not talking about mirrorless. In mirrorless, it's even more dramatic. So even if you're talking about mirrorless, as you can see, the lenses are huge. Like, your weight of the camera is only coming from the lens. So for instance, I have Canon EOS 800D and 17-55 f2.8 lens, basically f4 in real world terms. So, but the lens is almost the same weight as basically the camera, and it's an APS-C lens. So be mindful of this. Like, when you buy a camera, do not be like extremely focused on, okay, how lightweight it is, because if it's a very good camera, there is a good chance you're gonna buy a very good lens for it. And there is a almost certainty that good lenses are generally big and heavy and bulky. So size wise these lenses are big. So these become the big part of your camera. And they have another advantage. Like, if you go to a photo shoot and, like, you know, you pull out a big camera, people take you more seriously, versus like you pull out a camera that has a puny lens. Then in terms of photographers who do this for a living, you have to be very mindful. That is the investment they are doing, not the camera body. Camera body, they change every you know, every 3 years or 4 years once they got their money worth. But lenses are supposed to be like for decades. Yes, there are lenses like old Nikkor lenses that has been working for, let's say, 12, 13, 50 year old Nikkor lenses are still working. You can buy L glasses that are like 10 years old, 15 years old, second hand, third hand, fourth hand, and they are still working. So for a photographer who is doing this for a living, not like me, I'm doing video for a living, not photography, you want to buy a lens that, like, you know, can serve multiple bodies. There are lenses that are so old, Voigtländer lenses, and you know, lenses that companies are not even around, but their lenses are working, and you can mount them in your current DSLR, and just, you have to do manual focusing obviously, but lenses are working. So from investment point of view, this becomes the core aspect. Your lenses collection becomes the main aspect where you're spending money, not the body. Body you can change, lenses will be the one that's you know, gonna hold you back. Now the reason why I want to warn you guys before buying any APS-C lens is simply because there was a lie that was sold to us, to everyone, is that smaller lens equals smaller lens. Now you might be like, okay, isn't that obvious? Yes and no. Yes, because for the field of view, that's absolutely true. So let's say a 300 millimeter lens is this big. For a full frame system, it will be this big for a micro four third. That's absolutely true. So for field of view, you're getting that absolutely correct. However, you also compromise your depth of field, basically the f-stop. Now this is a very good image that I found. Now if it's not showing up clearly, I'll paste from my during video editing stage. Now as you can see, this guy, and I will have linked the description down below which video I'm referring this from, it is GH5, so which has 2x crop, basically micro four third. So he put 45 millimeter f1.8 lens and took this photo. Now it has very good background suppression. However, you look at Sony A9, which is full frame 85 millimeter, because I said this has 2x 2x on your field of view. Now that is f1.8, so field of view wise both are same. You can see like from head to like waist you are seeing the field of view exactly the same. However, this is f1.8, this is f1.8, the difference is dramatic here. So for this reason, if you actually want that shallow depth background field, you not gonna get it if you buy a lens that is made for APS-C and says that, you know, f1.8. So what does that mean? Like for us, it was sold as this picture, like, you know, if you have micro four third or APS-C, you're gonna get small lenses, and if you have big frame, you have to suffer the consequence. But that's not true. Like in reality, if you try to get a lens that is compensated for that thing, you are spending more or less the exact same amount of money, exact same weight, exact same size also. To illustrate this a bit more vibrantly, let's took a very closer example. So I urge you to be mindful. Like for instance, if you buy something like this, which is for full frame, you are far more comfortable, upgrading your camera body in the future than you are somewhere else. And especially for Nikon and Canon, because they really don't put effort into their APS-C bodies. Like Nikon did try to put some serious effort into their D500 series body, which is pretty good. The camera body is pretty good, very good autofocus, you know, flawless buffer system, and the fact it has dual cutthroat. Canon, I cannot truly say that it has anything in APS-C that is like whoa, other than the fact that it has dual pixel autofocus. So if you have DSLRs of either from Nikon or Canon, sooner or later you want to upgrade. Now if you're doing this properly, like if you are like, you know, let's just bought a camera and you want to do low level photography, I have seen many photographers who are using 3100 Nikon 3100 with basically the kit lens. Now there is nothing wrong with it, but if you really want to push your quality, you need higher quality lens. So higher quality lens for all these three system only appears in basically full frame. The lenses, as in my last episode video where I talked about Sony A series cameras, A6500, they have lenses that are flawless from spec sheet point. Like, you know, the aperture is very good, the zoom range is very good, but they don't even project the whole sensor. Basically the sensor corners are being cut out because on wide angle they can't even project it. Like those sort of thing is not acceptable in full frame, simply because anybody who buys full frame lens, generally they have a lot of money, generally they have a lot of reach, generally they are serious about their work. So in those sort of scenarios, Sony cannot afford to release a lens that's like, yeah, it's a full frame lens but does not project, you know, the projection area is not big enough. So for this sort of scenario, you have to be mindful. Good lenses are generally made for full frame. Now, supply and demand plays a very crucial role here, because as I already showed, I've seen many people who have APS-C system and almost all of them uses kit lenses. Now, on full frame, it's called almost invert of that, because kit lenses that are for full frame are generally better. And on top of that, generally most of the bodies that are sold generally sold as body only for full frame. So in those sort of scenarios, there is very large demand for a full frame lens and there is also a supply for it. So it ends up being cheaper. To give you this idea, I was thinking about buying this lens. Like this is, everybody's darling lens, Sigma 18-35 f1.8. So everybody's like, whoa. Now I was also like, whoa. But then I was like, after learning about photography with more detail, with more experience, I realized this f1.8 is basically f2.8. Now that's still brighter, than my f2.8 lens. Why? Because both are getting cropped. So this is getting cropped to 2.8, that is getting cropped to f4. So this is bright lens, f2.8 is a bright lens. However, this is costing upwards of 70,000. Now, if you are not familiar with the Indian rupees, do not pay attention to it, just pay attention to the number. Now, there is a full frame lens from Tamron that is roughly 90,000, basically 20% more cost. From these to this, there's 20% more cost. However, this is for APS-C only. This is for full frame. That means you can easily mount it for your APS-C system. And this goes from 24 to basically 70. Meaning this has a much smaller range, that has much larger range. This is F2.8, that is F2.8 on a full frame. This is not F1.8. So not only you are only spending 20% more, you are getting more range, basically how much you can zoom in. So this is going from 1.9 to 2.9. So you're getting more range. That's awesome. That is for full frame. And it has vibration compensation. This does not have it. So all things considered, if I had bought this, I would have regretted it. Not because this is a bad lens. I mean, like, practically it is bad lens, simply because way too in this camera, as in Canon EOS 800D, everybody who buys this is like, yeah, you have to buy that USB dock and then reconfigure it. So without that, this lens misses focus. The lack of vibration compensation simply means you have to be in broad daylight, or in low light you have to push up your ISO, and you're like, you don't need to push up. You need to push up, otherwise you will end up in a scenario where your images are very noisy. So I've seen the images out of this. This is a very sharp lens, but lack of vibration compensation flats out, you know, removes it. However, this might make a good system for those who have Sony APS-C camera, because they have IBUS basically. So in those sort of scenario, if I had bought this, I had only put 20% more capital, and I would have gotten a lens that it has more reach. Now you might be like, okay, that must be very heavy, this must be very lightweight, because it's APS-C only. This is 800 grams, as in it's substantially heavy. That's 900. So for only 100 grams more and only 20% more capital, you are getting more reach. You know, basically wider aperture simply means because you can put it in on full frame, and vibration compensation. So this should give you a very clear idea. Please do not jump into, like, you know, okay, I'm gonna get a, you know, APS-C body and APS-C lenses. Buy full frame lenses. And if you don't decide to, like, let's say I don't want to move to full frame, no problem, you still have good lenses, because even APS-C lens that have similar depth of field, the size and weight is more or less the same. And supply and demand will simply prefer full frame over APS-C any day of the week, because more APS-C cameras are sold. That's absolutely true, but very few APS-C lenses are sold. Full frame lenses go off the factory like, you know, hotcakes, but APS-C lenses, because those people who are buying APS-C cameras, if they are serious about it, they will buy full frame lens, because sooner or later they would wish to upgrade. For this reason, please be mindful. Like, this lens, I was this close to buying, but then I'm like, nope, this lens would have made more sense. Only 20% more price and you get a lot more features and quality. So please understand that this does not apply to Fuji Film, because Fuji Film as a company, as you can check my X-T2 video, it's linked here. They are a very smart company. They are solely focused on APS-C. That's why their lenses have very high quality. However, their lens range is not that vast. They don't have 300 lens selection. So please be mindful of that. And before you jump into any system, please check the lens before you buy a body. Before you jump into, like, okay, Nikon or Canon, please check the lens. Now, of course, from Nikon and Canon, that does not make too much difference, simply because both of these lenses are available for Nikon and Canon. So this was my warning for you, all of you guys who is, like, you know, budding photographer or hobbyist who has APS-C system. Don't buy this. Buy this and you will be very glad that you did. Like, 100 grams more, yes, that's more, but you will be able to use that lens far longer and you have more reach. So all things combined, please be mindful. Please don't jump into, like, APS-C lens. They have very shitty quality outside of Fujifilm, obviously. And third-party lenses will not make any sense. Supply and demand does not support it. So for this was my presentation on why you should not buy APS-C specific lenses. I hope you liked it or learned from it. In that case, please leave a like. If you didn't, don't worry about it. You can dislike it. And I would urge you to leave a comment what you want to see in the next episode of Camera Tuesday. And please subscribe, share it amongst your friends. And if you're free, press the bell icon. And as always, thanks for watching.